Hello and a very good morning. It's 10 a.m. It's Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Frank Pereira. Here are the headlines. North Korea says it has successfully tested a hydrogen bomb, a far more powerful thermonuclear device than uranium or plutonium bombs. Prime Minister Narendra Modi urges Nawaz Sharif to take action against those involved in the Pathankot terror attack. NIA to seek voice samples from Pakistan to corroborate evidence. Government putting optics over outcomes charges the Congress asks Prime Minister to take opposition into confidence on engaging Pakistan. Supreme Court to hear 7 PILs against Delhi government's odd even car rationing scheme. Petitions question exemptions. Government claims pollution levels have improved. And an emotional Barack Obama cracks down on gun laws in the US. Gun sellers now expected to conduct stricter checks on buyers. Our top focus on the bulletin now. North Korea successfully carried out its first hydrogen bomb test on Wednesday. A state television news reader said the test was performed at 10 a.m. on January 6, 2016 to coincide with what she called the strategic determination of the Workers' Party. Seismologists detected a 5.1 magnitude tremor next to its main atomic test site in the northeast of the country. The test comes 2 days before North Korean leader Kim Jong-un's birthday. Japan said it was convening a Security Council meeting after North Korea's nuclear test. The Japanese Met Agency is conducting analysis of data and will release its findings soon. Moving on now, the National Investigation Agency has categorically said that the terrorists who attacked the IAF base at Pathankot were from Pakistan. Revelations have led Prime Minister Narendra Modi in seeking clear action from Pakistani Premier Nawaz Sharif. Meanwhile, flying has resumed at the airbase and all vital security assets have been secured. Combing operations, however, will continue for today as well for security purposes. Here's a detailed report.
After the deadly terror attack in Pathankot, Pakistan under scrutiny once again. Prime Minister Narendra Modi on Tuesday urged Pakistani Premier Nawaz Sharif to ensure firm and immediate action. Sharif himself called Modi soon after the government announced that security forces killed all the 6 Pathankot terrorists.
This is not the first time Pakistan has given such an assurance, but the Prime Minister calling the Prime Minister here is, I think, maybe rare, and therefore it should be welcome. I think what we have to now wait for is what demonstrable action Pakistan will take against the elements which are anti-India.
The NIA says there was little doubt that the terrorists were from Pakistan. The agency is expected to seek voice samples of the mother of a gunman who spoke to her before the strike. The gunmen are believed to have been sent by Pakistan-based Jaish-e-Mohammed. This is the same group that tried to attack Parliament in 2001.
Thoda information mujhe bhi malum hai kaise aaya hai, lekin I can't give it obviously because NIA is investigating. Anything under investigation cannot be detailed out. Some detail I cannot express. Let them complete the investigation. I can tell you this much, that they have got initial leads, how they have come and from where they have come.
Pakistan National Security Advisor General Nasir Khan Janjua also called up his Indian counterpart Ajit Doval. Doval and Janjua talked about various information and leads like the Pakistani numbers which the attackers had called.
It's not with the Prime Minister Mia Nawaz Sharif. The problem is with the judiciary of Pakistan. Pakistan's judiciary is extremely, you know, is dominated by Jamaat-e-Islami, and which in the past has taken a very anti-India stance. So the problem comes from there, you know.
The terrorist made several calls from a mobile phone of a local jeweler to places in Pakistan, including Bhawalpur, where they spoke to their handlers and family members. Janjua's call came hours before Sharif's telephonic conversation with Modi. Pakistan has already said it is working on leads provided by India. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Meanwhile, in the wake of the Pathankot attack, the national capital will remain on high alert till Republic Day. The centre has asked Delhi police to be prepared to foil any attempt by terrorists to carry out strikes in the city. The directive has come after intelligence inputs suggested the presence of at least 6 to 10 Jaish-e-Mohammed terrorists in the Delhi NCR region who may have crossed over into India from Pakistan via Punjab. Security has been beefed up at the IGI airport. Both domestic and international flights have been asked to upgrade the scale of security, with some passengers being made to undergo secondary ladder checking in some flights. Staff of several airlines have been sensitized about the alert, asking them to report any suspicious movement or object. Meanwhile, the Congress has upped the ante against the NDA government over the terror attack in Pathankot, raising questions on the government's policy of engagement with Pakistan. The government has, however, dismissed the allegation, saying that the Congress was just trying to score political points on the issue of national security.
A day after the guns fell silent at the Pathankot airbase, the main opposition, the Congress, stepped up its attack on the NDA government. The party has challenged the government to come clean on the grounds for resumption of dialogue with Pakistan.
Dr. Manmohan Singh and the UPA government were clear that it has to be an approach of outcome over optics. That approach has been reversed. It's optics first and outcome later. After the optics have been over on 25th of December, let the Prime Minister share with the country what is the assured outcome.
Other political parties too joined the Congress in seeking cancellation of further dialogue with Pakistan.
ये वार्ता करने का उपयुक्त माहौल नहीं है। हम पार्टी हमारी मांग करती है कि 15 तारीख को जो विदेश सचिव स्तर की वार्ता है उसको कुछ समय के लिए टाल दिया जाए।
But what has perhaps made matters worse for the ruling party is that its ally, the Shiv Sena, has also raised questions on the government's policy of engagement with Pakistan.
पाकिस्तान कभी भी अपने साथ कोई वार्ता नहीं करना चाहता, किसी विषय पे चर्चा करने का उनका कोई मकसद नहीं है। पाकिस्तान का मकसद इतना है कि भारत में अस्थिरता फैला के वो अपनी राजनीति वहां के जो नेता लोग हैं और जो सत्ता में होते हैं वो करना चाहते हैं। और हमारे सामने में जो लिखा है मैं उसका समर्थन करता हूँ।
The government meanwhile has rebutted all the allegations, terming them as tactic for scoring political points.
कांग्रेस के मित्रों को भी ये समझना चाहिए कि राजनीतिक लड़ाई अपनी जगह पर है, लेकिन राष्ट्रीय हितों की जहाँ बात होती है वहाँ पर एक स्वर में एक भावना, और वो भावना राष्ट्रीय सुरक्षा की भावना होनी चाहिए, राष्ट्रीय सम्मान की भावना होनी चाहिए, राष्ट्रीय स्वाभिमान की भावना होनी चाहिए, और इसमें किसी तरह की सियासत नहीं होनी।
The terror attack on the Pathankot airbase, which lasted 3 days, came less than a week after Prime Minister Narendra Modi made an unscheduled stop in Lahore to meet his Pakistani counterpart. Foreign secretaries of both nations are also set to meet later this month. With Shyam Sundar, Vishal Dahiya, Rajya Sabha TV, Delhi.
Well, it's time for a short break now, but news and updates will continue on the other side. Stay tuned, we'll be right back.
पार्टी किसकी तरफ से, आप नाराज हैं या बीजेपी आपको नाराज कर रही है?
हर परिवार में अगर दो चार बार ऐसी बात होती है, इसका मतलब ये नहीं कि नाराजगी, अगर तथा कथित नाराजगी हो तो परमानेंट हो जाएगी।
अभी लीडर्स इस समय दर्पण दिखाने का काम कर रहे हैं। यू आर ऑल्सो शोइंग दैट दर्पण यू आर सेइंग, बट ऑल दीज पीपल आर गेटिंग साइडलाइन इन द पार्टी।
उफ ना करेंगे, लव सी लेंगे, आंसू पी लेंगे।
अमिताभ बच्चन हैज नॉट एक्नॉलेज्ड द काइंड ऑफ हेल्प एंड सपोर्ट व्हिच यू गेव हिम इन द इनिशियल इयर्स।
हो गई सो हो गई, रात गई, बात गई, बदनाम हुआ, सुभाष गई।
Watch to the point with actor politician Shatrughan Sinha only on Rajya Sabha Television.
Down the ages, jewelry has been the pride of the Indian culture. In the Harappan period, it attained perfection in flattened gold bands. From the Mauryan period came the exquisite gold brooches. Many ornaments were an extension of religious practices, like the Gauri Shankaram Rudraksh necklace worn by the temple priest. Rings with lids preserve the taweez that held secret messages and sometimes even poison. Tradition dating back centuries. A cultural heritage that inspires and warms at once. Magic that awes. Rajya Sabha Television brings you events that embrace the wonders of India's classical arts. Conversations with the biggest names in the culture and music. Rajya Sabha Television, democracy at work.
Welcome back. You're watching Rajya Sabha Television. Well, the Delhi High Court will today hear at least seven PILs against the Aam Aadmi Party government's odd even car rationing scheme. Some of the PILs have challenged the entire scheme as being arbitrary or ill-conceived. Others are against exemptions given to women drivers and two-wheelers. The latest petition claims the scheme violates fundamental rights of equality, freedom of movement and right to practice any profession or occupation guaranteed under the Constitution. Meanwhile, the Delhi government said on Tuesday that the cut in vehicular emission due to rolling out the odd-even scheme has resulted in definitive decline in pollution levels. The government said data collected from over 55 locations showed a clear trend of improving air quality in several areas. Over 41 lakh commuters travelled by the Delhi Transport Corporation buses in the city. The metro also saw around 21 lakh commuters till 8 p.m. yesterday. Well, the Supreme Court upheld its ruling on the ban on sale of large diesel vehicles in Delhi. It also sought documentary proof on whether diesel vehicles are less or more polluting than petrol. Here's more.
Do your cars emit oxygen? This is what the Supreme Court asked major car manufacturers, including Toyota and Mercedes, who want the ban on their larger diesel cars in Delhi to be revoked. The court was stern as it upheld its ruling of the ban on the sale of large diesel vehicles in Delhi. The top court also asked for documentary proof on whether diesel vehicles are less or more polluting than petrol. In other steps, the Supreme Court has banned the entry of heavy commercial vehicles from four additional entry points, NH2, NH10, NH58 and State Highway 57 into Delhi. However, it has allowed the entry of heavy commercial vehicles which are Delhi-bound on payment of pollution cess. The court also asked the Delhi government not to deny NOC to 10-year-old diesel vehicles and 16-year-old petrol vehicles for being sold outside NCR. The court also extended the deadline for taxis in National Capital Region to convert to CNG mode from 1st of March to 31st of March. It has asked the centre to set up 104 gas stations in 10 districts of NCR. The direction came when it was pointed out that the commercial vehicles will face shortage of CNG stations. The bench said process to provide the stations should be completed by 31st of March. Earlier in December, the Supreme Court had ruled that cars with engine capacity of more than 2000 cc cannot be sold in the capital until 31st of March this year. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Moving on now, Finance Minister Arun Jaitley recorded his statement in the Delhi court in a criminal defamation complaint filed by him against Chief Minister Arun Kejriwal and five other AAP leaders. Jaitley told Chief Metropolitan Magistrate Sanjay Khanagwal that Kejriwal and others had made false and defamatory statements against him and his family members. The union minister has sued the AAP leaders over allegations of corruption made by them. They have accused Jaitley of wrongdoing when he headed the Delhi cricket body DDCA. Jaitley has filed a criminal defamation case and a civil suit demanding 10 crore rupees in damages and sought prosecution for offences that entail imprisonment of up to 2 years.
This was a criminal defamation complaint, and complainant Shri Arun Jaitley ji, he recorded his statement. He produced all the evidence whereby these accused had made certain false and defamatory statements.
Arun Jaitley ji ne detail se apna bayan court ke samne diya aur 6 ke 6 logon ne specifically jo jo baatein defamatory kahi un sabko unhone uddhat kiya. Uske baad Rajat Sharma ji ka us mamle mein गवाह के तौर पे उनका वो रहा, केवल इतना ही आज कोर्ट की प्रोसीडिंग में हुआ है।
पब्लिक लाइफ में अरुण जेटली जी का इतना लंबा जीवन है और उसमें उन पे किसी ने चोट करने की कोशिश की है, ईमानदारी की हमेशा से वो मिसाल रहे हैं, तो मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि एक अच्छा सबक कोर्ट के द्वारा जो बेफालतू बेमतलब बिना उसके बोलते हैं उनको एक जबरदस्त चपेट पड़ेगी।
Well, let's now bring you up to date with the news and events lined up for the day in the day ahead. Finance Minister Arun Jaitley will hold the pre-budget consultation meeting with representatives of industry and trade groups in North Block today. MOS Finance Jayant Sinha, along with the Finance Secretary and other secretaries of the Finance Department, will also take part in the meeting. The general budget will be presented in Parliament's budget session starting in February. Home Minister Rajnath Singh will inaugurate the 7th National Conference of Women in Police at the CRPF Academy in Gurgaon. CRPF is hosting the 3-day conference that is held once every 2 years. The event will also witness participation by women police officers, personnel from the rank of Constable to DG from almost all the state and central police forces. SPI Chairman Arundhati Bhattacharya and filmmaker Prakash Jha will also take part in the various discussions. Vice President Mohammad Hamid Ansari will inaugurate the NCC Republic Day camp and address cadets and officers at the Garrison Parade Ground in Delhi Cantonment. The Vice President will meet the youth and children from Jammu and Kashmir as well. He will also release a book titled State Policy and Conflicts in Northeastern India, authored by Dr. K.S. Subramanian. Today is the second day of President Pranab Mukherjee's visit to West Bengal. The President will inaugurate a new building of Vidyanagar College at South 24 Parganas. He will also inaugurate the 200th birth anniversary of Pandit Madan Mohan Tarklankar at Bilwagram in Nadia district today. The Delhi High Court will hear the call drop case today. TRAI has mandated telecom operators to compensate consumers with the 1 rupee per call to 3 dropped calls per day starting from January 2016, which has been unanimously opposed by the telcos. Delhi High Court in December had asked TRAI not to take any coercive action against telcos in case of non-compliance. It's time for a short break now, but news and updates will continue on the other side. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Who should be in power is left to be determined by the people.
I want all minorities to have an honorable place in the Union of India.
Declaration was that zamindari would be abolished, for which fair compensation would be paid.
There is no dispute whatsoever that the executive should be separated from the judiciary.
The protagonists of Hindi, in their enthusiasm, have gone too far.
Greatest danger in the future may not be that the center will interfere too much, but that the units may resent the guidance of the center.
The future constitution of India would be a pyramidal structure based on the village panchayats.
I move that the constitution be passed.
Welcome back. You're watching Rajya Sabha Television. Well, in a series of measures to check rising incidents of gun violence in the US, President Barack Obama used his executive powers to implement stricter gun laws. A visibly emotional Obama made a passionate call for a national sense of urgency to limit gun violence. Obama used his powers after previous attempts failed to get the strong gun lobby and opposition Congress on board.
The time I think about those kids, it gets me mad. And by the way, it happens on the streets of Chicago every day.
The irony was unmissable. The occupant of one of the powerful offices in the world reduced to tears so, as he cracked down on gun laws that Congress blocked.
All of us need to demand a Congress brave enough to stand up
In an emotional speech, U.S. President Barack Obama wiped back tears as he remembered children who died in a mass shooting in Newtown School.
From every family who never imagined that their loved one would be taken from our lives by a bullet from a gun. Every time I think about those kids, it gets me mad.
The only country Obama explained why he needed to use his presidential powers to bring about a change that had been so consistently resisted by Congress.
Second Amendment rights are important. Well, there are other rights that we care about as well. And we have to be able to balance them. Because our right to worship freely and safely, that right was denied to Christians in Charleston, South Carolina. And that was denied Jews in Kansas City. And that was denied Muslims in Chapel Hill and Sikhs in Oak Creek.
Now, I'm very proud of what the president called for this morning with his executive order. And I was pleased because some of what he called for, I had advocated for back a couple of months ago during our debates and during the campaign. Comprehensive background checks, closing the gun show loophole, closing the online loophole, closing what's called the Charleston loophole, closing the kind of chances and opportunities that people who shouldn't have guns can take advantage of and get them. And that includes ending the immunity from liability for gun makers and sellers, the only industry in America that has that. I voted against that when I was in the Senate. I thought it was a mistake then.
The Second Amendment is so important. They're trying. They're not going to take your guns away, folks. They're not going to take your guns away. Not going to do it. They're trying. They're talking about the bullets. They're talking about. And then, as you see, President Obama is on television.
Rules have been announced, she believes. Under the new plan to curb the rising gun menace, all gun sellers must be registered as dealers and must conduct background checks on prospective buyers. Current exemptions will be removed on online and gun show sellers. States must provide information on people disqualified due to mental illness or domestic violence. FBI to increase workforce processing background checks by 50%. And Congress will be asked to invest $500 million to improve access to mental health care. Obama also accused gun lobby of taking U.S. Congress hostage for not coming on board to restrict the gun culture.
Gun lobby may be holding Congress hostage right now, but they cannot hold America hostage. We do not have to accept this carnage as the price of freedom.
However, opponents of tighter gun rules spoke out against the executive action announced by Obama, while people have welcomed the decision.
We're all concerned that we're going to be restricted to having certain things that may not fit our criteria. So, yeah, we get the phone calls and people are checking in, but rightfully so. Someone's trying to say, tell me what I can and can't have. Everybody comes off the couch and they go looking.
I think we have a ridiculously high rate of gun violence in our country compared to other countries, so something really needs to be done about it, and I'm glad that he made that decision.
According to the data released in 2013, over 33,000 deaths by gun violence reported in U.S. The U.S. Constitution's Second Amendment gives Americans the right to have arms, a right that is fiercely defended. Legal challenges to the changes are expected, and Republican presidential candidates have promised to reverse his order if they win the White House. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Some more international news now. Bodies of 34 migrants, at least seven of them children, were found at two sites along Turkey's Aegean coast on Tuesday after their rubber boat capsized in bad weather and high seas. The migrants were trying to cross to the nearby Greek island of Lesbos. The tragedies are the deadliest so far reported in the Aegean in 2016. They come as the European Union seeks to push Turkey to halt the flow of migrants across its borders in exchange for financial help. Here's a roundup of the other international news in our World Wrap. Pakistan and Sri Lanka signed 8 agreements on defence, security, anti-terrorism, combating money laundering and terror financing in Colombo on Tuesday. Also sealed was a landmark deal to sell 8 JF-17 Thunder fighter jets to Sri Lanka. The deal came through after Pakistan's Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif met with Sri Lanka's Prime Minister Maithripala Sirisena in Colombo to strengthen bilateral cooperation between the two countries. French President François Hollande on Tuesday unveiled plaques in memory of the victims of the jihadist rampage a year ago that started with an attack on satirical weekly Charlie Hebdo. It lasted 3 days, claiming 17 lives. The January 2015 attacks were dubbed France's 9/11. They culminated in the November 13th attacks in Paris that left 130 dead. Saudi diplomats based in Iran arrived in Riyadh after their kingdom cut ties with Tehran after an attack on their embassy. Saudi Arabia had cut ties with Iran on Sunday, responding to the storming of its embassy in Tehran in an escalating row between the Middle East powers over Riyadh's execution of a Shia Muslim cleric. Other countries like Bahrain and Sudan have also cut diplomatic ties with Iran. The US-led coalition says the Islamic State's territory has shrunk by 40% from its maximum expansion in Iraq and by 20% in Syria in 2015. The IS lost around 30% of the territory they once held as the international forces have pushed the militant organization now to several cities, including Tikrit in the north of Baghdad and Ramadi to the west. Moving on to some sports news now. Mumbai schoolboy Pranav Danawade rewrote history books after scoring a 1,000-run innings in the inter-school cricket tournament organized by the Mumbai Cricket Association. Playing for KC Gandhi School, the 15-year-old hit a staggering 59 sixes and 129 fours in his unbeaten innings of 1,009 runs as his team declared on 1,465 for three, another world record. With the marathon innings, Pranav broke the 116-year-old record of the highest runs in a single innings. The record of 628 runs was previously set by English batsman Arthur Collins. Indian legend Sachin Tendulkar congratulated the youngster for the record and encouraged him to scale new heights. Maharashtra government has announced that it will take care of the education and coaching expenses of Pranav Danawade, the son of an auto rickshaw driver.
मैं मॉडर्न क्रिकेट लवला खेळतो तिकडे मोबिन सर आहे आणि इरफान सर आहे त्यांनी पण मला म्हणजे खूप मदत केली क्रिकेटची मला आता लक्ष पहिले स्टेट खेळायचं आता 19ला जाईल माझं पहिले 19 स्टेट खेळायचं महाळू जसं एज वाढेल तसं 23 रणजी वगैरेला चान्स खेळायचा
जो स्पार्क आज प्रणवने दिखाया है महाराष्ट्र सरकार के स्पोर्ट्स डिपार्टमेंट की ओर से हम ये ध्यान देंगे कि वो सही दिशा में शेप होकर एक अच्छा क्रिकेटियर आने वाले दिनों में हम हिंदुस्तान की ओर से दुनिया को दे सकते हैं।
Let's now bring you up to date with the other overnight sports news in our sports beat. The Indo-Spanish pair of Leander Paes and Marcel Granollers reached the second round of the Chennai Open with a straight set victory in the opening round. The pair defeated Taro Daniel and John Millman 6-2, 6-3. However, in the men's singles, Somdev Devarman crashed out of the first round after losing 3-6, 6-3, 3-6 to Russian wildcard Andrei Rublev. South African batsman Themba Bavuma became the first coloured player to score a ton for the Proteas. The hosts continued to frustrate the English bowlers, with captain Hashim Amla scoring 201 and Bavuma on an unbeaten 102 as South Africa declared at 627 for 7 in their first innings. England were 16 for no loss at the end of day 4, leading by 18 runs. Jordan Ibe's goal gave Liverpool a slender advantage as they beat Stoke City in the first leg of the semi-final of the Capital One Cup. Ibe, who came on as a substitute for Philippe Coutinho, struck at the far post in the 37th minute to give the Reds a 1-0 victory. The second leg will be played at Anfield. World number one Serena Williams retired from her Hopman Cup match against Australian Jarmila Wolfe due to a knee injury. Williams was trailing 7-5, 2-1 when she decided not to continue after receiving medical treatment. Serena has earlier pulled out of the tie against Ukraine with inflammation to her knee. That's it on this edition of The Bulletin. Have a good day.